Sahana Bhavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinavadi Tamastuma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. You must be wondering what the Swami has to come and speak to managers. But my very first discourse that I heard of Swami Chinmayananda in Bombay, and he was addressing to all the managing directors, CEOs of some of the largest companies in India, and somehow I heard about it. I'd heard his spiritual discourses on the Bhagavad Gita, but I had just joined business at that time, right out of college, and I was handling the family business. I was really curious to know what this Swami has to say about, you know, business, about management, etc. But we forget that some of the largest institutions in the world that have been going on and managed have been spiritual institutions. Is it not? So what must be their management philosophy, management methodology, that when most companies survive maximum 3 or 4 generations, spiritual organizations have survived, grown, thrived over centuries. If you see Bhagwan Shankaracharya's institution, if you have seen, even if you say Vatican, all this have survived over the centuries. What is the method that they employ? But I was very curious, what is the Swami to say? And interestingly, he was speaking on this subject. The title was slightly different, but he was speaking on this subject. And he said that we can go abroad, we can go to universities to learn technique of management. Learn technique of management. And techniques of management, what works in the West will not work in the East. In America, if you go and put your hand around one of your officer or staff and tell him, how is everything at home, how is your wife, he'll look back at you and say, none of your business. No? While here, if the boss just looks at the pune and inquires him about his family, he's a slave for life. You know that, right? Techniques will change. What was working in the world till 2008, after the 2008 recession, you know what a drastic change came around the world and in all, you know, companies. With governments changing, economic situations changing, banks collapsing, naturally, you realize that if we do not adapt or change according to the times and find out more and more effective means of management, then a company that is there for centuries can overnight shut down. Whatever may be also the principles on which a company has been established, whatever may be the systems in place, but eventually we all know that the success of a department or of a company depends upon the manager. A good manager can lift the company to great heights, And the moment the manager goes wrong, everything goes wrong in the company. So it's a very responsible title. It's a very responsible position, even if it is only a manager of a certain branch, division in the company. So finally, it is the manager that determines the success or the failure of the company. But we forget that who is the manager of our life and with whom do we manage, whether the company or the family or the country. It is finally our mind. Mind is the manager of our life, and it is with this mind only that we manage everybody. We may have all the knowledge. We may have studied and get degrees. We must have even gone through training. But the day your mind is agitated, the day your mind is disturbed, you know that we cannot apply any of these things. We may have a lot of spiritual knowledge also. People might even think, great Mahatma. But when a situation comes and you get agitated, that the moment you make your mistake. Is it not? Therefore, finally, it is our mind that applies our knowledge effectively in the actions in the world outside. Therefore, our rishis concentrated on the mind. And when you think about it, these great Mahatmas, did Buddha, well, Buddha was a prince, but did Buddha go into any management college or even had a chance of managing his kingdom? Not yet. And yet, what a trend he started, what a organized path he started. When Swami Chinmayananda came down from the Himalayas, when Narendra went to Sri Ramakrishna Paramhamsa, were there some kind of managers who finally managed such great institutions with hundreds of schools, hundreds of medical centers, spiritual centers around the world? You wonder how one person can look after all this without incentive but inspiration. Not only our mind works with these two, inspiration and incentive. You know also, even now, as parents, how do you manage the emotions of your children? Study well, I will give you one new gadget. You give them an incentive. And that incentive prompts them to manage things properly. I'll give you one hilarious example. There was, long ago, in a Gurukula, a guru told his disciple that, here is the cow, take it to the other side of the forest and give it to the sage there and bring some money for the ashram. And he told, we do not have much money to feed. See that you don't lose the cow, because young boys, they'll sleep and the cow will go away. On the way, he met alone, he was there. And his guru said that if you lose the cow, you don't come back here. On the way, he met one dacoit. And he had a big stick in his hand and told him, give me the cow, otherwise I will kill you. And he was pleading to him, begging of him, telling him, please, please don't take my cow, my life will come to an end, my fellow students will not have food, my guru will be upset with me. He went on explaining, but that Daku said, I am going to, and he had a big stick in his hand, one hit on his head, he would have collapsed. And he didn't have anything in his, to fight also back. That time, that Daku recognized that he was carrying some packet, which the, those Gurukulas, means they were schools, the Guru Mata had tied it for him and given to eat on the way. So it was a packet, and he said, "What is this?" He said, "Please, please, please, don't take that." You know. He said, "Don't give it to me, otherwise I'm going to hit you." Then suddenly you see the brilliance of this boy. This boy said, "You see, I'm just coming from my Gurukula. There I have told that if you steal, you will go to hell for 5 million years, and that too also you steal from a brahmachari. No, you will go for 5 million years into hell." So he said, "I don't care. I need it right now." He said, "No, I'm not saying don't take it. But if you give me something in return, then it is not stealing. You will not go to hell." He said, "If I had anything, why would I be stealing?" He said, "You can take it. Okay, you can give me your stick." And he thought stick for whatever is in the pocket and the cow. He gave the stick to this young brahmachari, and that brahmachari hit him one on his head and he fell down. And just when he was running away from there, he said, "Wait, wait, wait. For the guru's cow, you did not have this intelligence. What is there in your pocket because of which, at least I'll know what I missed, no? What was there in your pocket that..." So he opens and shows him, Guru Mata had given him laddu. For the cow, his intelligence didn't come out, but for the laddu, it came, no? So our mind works with incentive, no doubt. How much promotion we get, how much promotion we give others and make them do. But incentive is there only for some time, because one thing is for sure, the greed of the mind never comes to an end. But that management which is based on inspiration, and not only managing of others, but when our mind is inspired by a principle, an ideal, a person, or a goal. When our mind is inspired by the goal that we adore, we admire, and at the same time we emote with, we love, like the laddu. Yeah? Cow, no, laddu. When we love, see from our own mind, what emanates from our mind itself is surprising. Therefore, first and foremost is that if we have a goal higher and nobler, besides only what I gain out of it, not only my mind becomes creative, innovative, because it has that dedication that I must attain that goal, and it is highly beneficial for me. The moment it gets into that mode, suddenly we release a source of intelligence, dynamism that is potentially in each and every one of us. In the 6th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, where Bhagwan Krishna is explaining to none other than Arjuna that how we make this mind powerful, single-pointed, and what is meditation, Bhagwan clearly tells Arjuna, Uddharet atmanatmanam na atmanam avasadayet. Atmaiva yatmana banduhu atmaiva ripuratmana. lift yourself by yourself. And having lifted yourself, na atmanam avasadayet. Don't allow yourself to fall again. Otherwise, all the time we are only falling up, up, down, up, down. Have you noticed? You have an ill health, you go to the doctor, take medication, go on a diet, everything, and when everything is okay, we again go back into the same lifestyle and we fall back into the same illness. Therefore, we don't improve our health. Same way in life, if we have progressed, whether we say in our monetary gains, whether we have progressed in our ability and talents, whether we have progressed in our spiritual growth, don't allow yourself to fall down again. But there's another beautiful meaning that our Guru gave us. It is not that don't allow yourself to fall down again. Na atmanam avasadayet has two more beautiful meanings. Do not look down, do not underestimate your own potential. I read somewhere so beautiful that the tragedy of human beings is not that they set high goals and don't achieve it. The tragedy is that we set very small goals for ourselves and we achieve it. I run a program based on the Bhagavad Gita called as Make It Happen. And generally not only budding entrepreneurs, etc., come for that session, but CEOs and managing directors of the companies, of the largest companies, have attended it. And you'll be surprised that even these people who are great achievers come to a state and then they blame it to old age, they blame it to society, they blame it to the economic situations, that they reach a plateau. Another great person has said that everybody finally tends towards incompetency. You must have realized also, because you're all managers, you employ someone, comes in, seems to bring in some new impetus in the company, and after some time you find them becoming complacent, their whole efficacy starts dwindling. Like in nature, everything flows downward. For it to go upward, it requires some dynamism. It requires some push. It requires some inspiration. Krishna says, na atmanam avasadayet, that even such achievers, when I have had one-to-one conversation with them and they have opened up, they've clearly pointed out that we feel that there's so much more to do, but we do not know how to break these barriers within ourselves and go beyond. And therefore Krishna says, na atmanam avasadayet. Don't ever underestimate yourself. Don't say that my education level is not as my superior manager. No. Do not underestimate yourself. You yourself are your best friend. You yourself are your deadliest enemy. Therefore, that quote says, the tragedy of human beings is not that they set high goals and don't achieve it, because we call that as failure, but that we set small goals and do achieve it. When I was making the course Make It Happen, I was studying also some courses that is going on in the market, and they always called about SMART goals. I'm sure you must have gone to seminars and heard the specific, measurable, achievable. If you go for an achievable goal, you don't have to go for a course for it. All great people are those who made the impossible possible. They're not people who just sat back and said, this much I can do. That you already know. We have to take our mind beyond what it can normally do. And it has the capacity. It has the tenacity. And each one of us, our rishis too have said that you are Brahman. You are infinite. And we say that I can't do this. And who is saying this in the Gita? Not an ordinary person. Arjuna was no failure in life. In fact, wherever he has gone, he's been successful. Even in the time of crisis, when they have been exiled, he's called as Dhananjaya because he went and brought wealth. Yeah. Even as a youngster, look at his concentration. That he sees only the eye of the bird, where even Yudhishthir sees the bird and Duryodhan sees the branch of the bird and the fruit, and Bhima sees the fruits that are hanging from it. No? That Arjuna, and therefore Gita is not spoken to some failure, is not to some starter, is one who has managed his success to such a height that he is the greatest hero, admired even by the stalwarts of society, admired even by his own teacher, who's one of the best teachers of archery. Not an ordinary person. Temporarily he went to the state of dejection. Therefore, how do we manage this mind that even in the state of crisis, even in the state of crisis, such great people collapsed. And the situation was not ordinary. He was a warrior. He has fought many battles. He's not afraid of death, nor is he really afraid of killing. But when you have to kill your own dear and near ones, even though it's a battle against evil, but if it was as simple that everybody was evil on that side, you could have fought the battle. But you have Bhishma, you have Drona. Imagine the situation. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita can lift us from the most agitated, depressive situation. Not situation, never depressive, mind. To a person of great success, not only, but even of significance. And imagine, Arjuna was already successful, but Krishna took him to the level of greatness, that he did not only be successful, many kings have been successful and we don't even hear about them, is it not? He not only made a successful person attain significance, that Arjuna not only made history, he made an epic. So what is that which lies within our own self? Krishna says, Uddhared Atmanatmanam. Lift yourself by yourself. Because infinite is the potential in each one of us. And even in society, economically, even in our country, in spite of whatever is happening, for those who put their mind to it, even in the state of calamity, they can bring about prosperity. This is what the Bhagavad Gita teaches us. This is what our spiritual knowledge traditions point out to us. And how does Krishna explain to Arjuna? He says in simple words, lift your mind, because your mind itself is the one you're going to live with, is your best friend. Your mind is your deadliest enemy. And if we have not learned to manage our mind, all external management will work for some time, and afterwards it begins to collapse, like everything in the world. Therefore, Krishna says, that mind which is under your management, is your best friend. That mind which dictates to you and is your boss. And you know how the mind moves. Now this, now that. Sankalpa, vikalpa. Sankalpa, vikalpa. Now this, now that. This doubt, that doubt. Should I do it? Should I not do it? I want this, but maybe I want this also. And now I'm sure you're listening to this from your children and grandchildren. What career should I take? Should I become a doctor? Should I become an engineer? No, I want to become an actor. No, actor, there's no money. No. See how the mind keeps on fluctuating? That mind under whose whims and fancies we are, that mind is our deadliest enemy. And that mind which we master is our best friend. Therefore, Guru Nanak Sahib says, Man jeete jag jeet. One who has conquered his or her mind has conquered the world. Not like an Alexander. Which means, no situation in the world, no circumstances can bog them down. And there is no question of if and but for such a person. The whole world is Mother Lakshmi, is the resource. We only know, we have to only apply our mind and see how we can generate that wealth which can be used by us and by society. And therefore, throughout the Gita, Bhagwan points out to Arjuna, keep your goals high. Even if you don't reach it, if you go onto the YouTube and type in Swami Chinmayananda, and especially if you type in life is a sport, and you'll get a few small clippets, very inspirational, of Pujya Gurudev. He points out, life is a sport. So what? Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. But keep your goals so high. Even if you don't reach it, wherever you reach will be far more than the small goals. Because very often, when we achieve our goal, we are very temporarily satisfied. And that becomes our own limitations. As a kid, I had difficulty throwing the ball, you know. How in cities, you live in buildings, children are playing cricket in the balcony, and if the ball falls down, nobody wants to come down the steps. Anybody passing, they say, throw it up, you know. And I used to be too embarrassed, because if I had to throw it, you know, on the second floor, it used to go on the first floor. So one day I was walking with an elder person, my elder cousin, and the ball came. So I said, you throw, you throw. The children were saying, I said, no, you throw, you throw. So he said, he looked at me, younger brother, he said, why don't you throw? I said, it's very embarrassing. If I throw on the second floor, it will go on the first floor. So he said, then here's the trick. You aim on the third floor, it'll go on the second floor. Anyway, the ball had come from the second floor, and I aimed on the third floor. It just went again to the first floor. So my cousin said, you better aim for the sky. It'll probably go to the second floor. That's why there's a saying, you know. Aim for the sky. If you don't reach there, at least you'll reach the palm tree. Therefore, keep our goals high. When I say high, we only think about linear progress. We always think more income, more profit for us, and more our individual salaries should increase. Really speaking, wealth is not a goal, it is a means. When we set goals, and I'm telling you, sometimes very often in the workshops I ask people, what is a goal? And all you hear is making more money is the goal. Having a target of making more money is the goal, you know. Starting so many more divisions is a goal. Having so much more products is a goal. But a goal that inspires us is that which not only gives us a gain, but creates a transformation that we become effective in more productivity. Therefore, Krishna says, keep your goal high, and high means the moment you just think about yourself, how much more millions will you make, and after those millions or crores, what are you going to do with it? You can just think, I have got this money, you can't even show to others, other the taxes will raid you, etc. Is it not? But if we keep our goal that with our work, how many more can benefit? We have all heard about Mahatma Gandhi. No doubt he was a student of the Gita. When he was in South Africa, insulted, personal insult, being thrown out from a first class compartment, even though he had a ticket, but because he was brown and not white, he was thrown out of the compartment. You can't go onto the train. He thought as a youngster this was unfair. He felt very insulted. And then when he went out and he saw this apartheid and these distinctions that were going on between the color of the people, he inspired all the people that this is unfair that we are going to be labeled or have identity cards as as cattle. Today we all have cattle cards, is it not? That you can be located anywhere now around the world. But he revolted against it. He got the masses. They went out. They were clobbered by the police. And then for years only he was writing journals. Nothing much he was able to achieve. But at the age of 40, when he came to 40, 45, when he came to India, the stalwarts of the Indian freedom movement asked him that now that you have come, what will you do in India? He said, you know, I've got a family. I have to earn my bread and butter. He didn't say dal bhat. Bread and butter I have to earn. They said, bread and butter will be plenty in the Raj. We want you to join the Indian freedom movement. See, we all like to show we are great. But the moment we get some responsibility, whether we show it outside or not, inside we chicken out or not. I can't do it. Oh, I don't want this responsibility. Everybody wants to be a leader, but leader is one who takes up responsibility even for the success and the failure of the company. But nobody wants to take responsibility for the failure of the team, and therefore very often people shy away from responsibility. Even Mahatma Gandhi did. And it was his belief, and I speak here about belief, which is very important. His belief was that the British Empire has not seen its sunset and will not see its sunset. If you start believing like this, that situations now are so bad that nothing can be done, yes, nothing can be done, because you know that you are always right, except when you are with your wife. We always think we are right, and when the mind thinks that you are right, if you think you can't, you're pretty much right, you can't. But if you think you can, you're pretty much right that you can. Be watchful of these negative thoughts. We think negative thoughts only when there's kama, krodha, lobha, moha, ahankar, matsarya. Many of these negative thoughts we know to keep away from. It's hard to control those also, but we try our best to keep away. But there are subtle thoughts in our mind which appear like angels. No? Even false humility. Even false spirituality. In spiritual institutions can't work without money. Have no guilt about money. We worship her as Lakshmi in the service of Narayana. You mean to say that when we have to build such hospitals, schools, etc., we sadhus who day and night work with no money in our pocket, how much you have to generate to start these institutions? And you know, donations don't come that much, always remember. But even little by little, how do you make it happen? But you even think sometimes the projects that spiritual institutions take up. When you think about the amounts, you wonder where is it even going to come from. But the moment you think it can't, it won't. The moment you think it can, and you do your best, see how the whole nature contrives for make it happen for you. Here Mahatma Gandhi, as Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, first immediately said, I do not think I can. With such stalwarts like you, with over the last two centuries could do nothing, and no one in the world has been able to do anything against the British, how do you think I will be able to help? I'd rather eat my bread and butter than try something which is a sure failure. But these people sent him the length and breadth of the country. And when he saw that in a country which is surrounded three sides by water, and the British were exploiting it by sending salt from England, and we could not make our own salt, seeing the poverty, seeing the suffering, he could no longer think about his bread and butter, because you know he would have been a very successful lawyer, but today nobody would have even remembered him, and nor his contribution to society would have been much. Even though he would have been an honest lawyer and could have probably brought some honesty into the judiciary system. But yet, who knows whether he would have even... And it's not about his name, but look at him. Once he felt for the people, once you feel for your team, once you feel for your country, when you feel for your company, not just someone else's responsibility, but each and every one of us are responsible for our country's prosperity and development. Pujya Gurudev, when he used to go to different countries and see their working inspiration, he would bring those ideas to India. Once when he went to Japan, and that time, as you know, in the 1970s and 80s, Japan was the top economy in the world. And when he went to Japan, he saw why it was that even an old person, whom normally we say retired at the age of 80, in his own house, whatever he could do was doing. And this old man was only pressing and making holes in a rubber which was going between the cycle wheels and packing it so neatly. And you know how Japanese, everything is so neat, everything is so elegant, and simplicity has its elegance. And sometimes, dirt is what we call as, being simple. He watched him, how each thing, how efficiently he did it, how neatly he did it, and with what pride he was working. But he had found that there was a whole bunch of these, insulators. So he asked him. And that also, he will not speak English. He would only speak Japanese. You think prosperity in India is because we speak English? He asked him, what are you doing? He was saying, I'm making the cycle buffers. And so he said, why have you thrown this? So he showed, some of them had an extra thing. Somebody had a little bit of a chip taken out, scratch. So Gurudev just laughed and just told him, he said, why did you throw it? Hardly anybody will notice if you put some of these in between and not too much damage. You know what he said? And look at his wisdom. Gurudev was just testing him. Because And he laughed. And those days in our country, that used to happen. He said, in my country, even if it was broken in two pieces, it would be in between the box, in between the container. So he said, no. Whether anybody knows I packed it or not in the billions of things that were exported. But when this goes to America and anyone reports that this was damaged, the quality of Japanese goods will be questioned. Japan's prices will come down. And if the economy of Japan suffers, I suffer. See his wisdom. And if what I make is a good product, the world will appreciate Japanese products, the markets will go high, and who benefits in that? I benefit. Therefore, when Krishna says that higher and nobler the goal, and even if you have achieved your success, now think how your success can help your team, how your success can help your company, how your success can help your nation, how it can help the world. And we'll think, what change can we do to the world? All we have to shift is our attention of thinking just about ourselves, but thinking by whatever I'm doing, maybe not even extra. If I'm a doctor, if only I change my attitude from how many patients I can get to how many patients I can cure, just a difference. Shift your goal from how many patients turn over to how many patients cured, which will bring about success, you tell me. Lasting success, even monetary success. A patient who is cured is your greatest publicity, is it not? You may have a lot of turnover, but eventually, if people are not cured, they'll come back again and again. One day they'll give up. No? All we have to do is change our attitude, change our vision. Higher and nobler our goal, our mind revels only in noble thoughts. These negative thoughts go away and our greater potential comes out from us. And look at Mahatma Gandhi. That man with a squeaky voice, you'll hardly hear him speak. If he said a word, the British Empire trembled. And the day he went and picked up a pinch of salt, after that the British Empire crumbled, never to rise up again. He made the impossible possible. And no great person was born that way. And all these great people have clearly pointed out that if we want to achieve anything, we must have mastery over the mind. The mind gets distracted by our senses. We have not to shut down the senses, otherwise there is no progress. But what we see, what we hear, what we entertain, that's why Rishi said, Badram karnebi shuniyama deva. Badram pashye makshabir yajatra. Not shut down your senses, but let only inspiring, auspicious, good thoughts come to your mind through your eyes, through your ears, through your senses. Mind gets disturbed when these are these external distractions. To some extent, if we keep the senses away from bad company, bad gossip, I'm not saying talking negative about someone, but just talking about negative about the situation. You know, now the situation, nothing can happen. You know, this company, nothing is going to happen. What about me making it happen? The moment you shift your mind's attention to something positive, immediately you'll find that inspiration comes in, enthusiasm comes in. In Hanumanji's life story, you see, he'd made impossible possible. And every time, whether it was jumping across the ocean, whether it was bringing Sushain from Lanka, whether it was going to bring Sanjeevani, all the committees and board members amongst the monkeys sat back and started thinking how impossible it was. And yes, it was not an easy task in a certain time to achieve it. But Hanumanji did not think whether it was possible or impossible. He knows it has to be done. And with that spirit that it's my duty and I have to do it. And with that dedication and love that it is for my Ram. It is for Dharma Palan. And he just went and did it and he made it possible. Yeah? So keep the senses under your mastery. Keep the mind with positive goals, positive inspiration beyond our selfish ego. I won't say self-sacrifice, that word is wrong. But be self-inclusive. Think as a company, think as a team, think as a country, and you will find that suddenly the inspiration of the mind increases. There are many things said about how to master this mind. But this one inspiration from the Gita, which I heard from Pujya Gurudev, and you see amongst your children also, see amongst your company staff also. Those who are fired by the goal, you don't have to tell them, don't take coffee break, don't take tea break, chai break. Those children who are inspired by a goal, you don't have to keep telling them, study, 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 study. But those children who are not, you have to constantly keep them under control. Keep the mind on something higher. Yeah. A little bit of check of distractions and suddenly see not only how much dynamism that comes due to that inspiration, but the beauty of it is that in such a single-pointed, quiet mind, in yoga, in Gita also, in Upanishads also, many techniques of mastering the mind. Not one. Many techniques are pointed out. But in which all this happens naturally is, keep your mind devoted. Highest, of course, being the infinite God. Yeah? Keep your mind dedicated to the highest and just be ready to do your best. Whatever comes our way is never failure. It is only a stepping stone to greater success. And such an inspirational person, such an inspirational manager, yadyad acharati sreshta tattat devetaro janaha sayat pramanam kurute lokas tadanu vartate. Till today people are wearing khadi because of Gandhi, is it not? Yeah. People will follow. It's infectious. Such management is infectious. Yeah. So when we keep that in our mind, and this is the way to manage our mind, in the same way to manage people, give them a goal that they are inspired by. And everything else will start happening. As simple as that. Yeah? So thank you very much for being an inspired audience. And I know the Ramco company and its various branches are doing a lot of work in society also, even philanthropy work. But all of you put together with your efficiency, with your management, bring prosperity to the country. Bring efficiency to the country. No, Swachh Bharat will not happen with the Prime Minister taking the... No? We have to make it happen. So I wish you all the best. You are the managers of, you know, high positions. You have to be higher than that also. So with, invoke the blessings of Bhagwan, and with devotion in our heart and faith in our heart. During moments of crisis, when you think nothing can happen, at least have faith in the one who makes it happen. Never lose that. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.